गुड
यस
इवनिंग एवरीवन। मैं रोटेरियन शुभा सिंह आप सभी लोगों का स्वागत करती हूँ, और स्पेशली मिस्टर नरेंद्र के रस्तोगी सर का। आज का
आज का
जो
जो
वेबिनार
वेबिनार
है
है
वो
वो
हमारे और
हमारे
आपके सबके
सबके
लिए
लिए
पर्सनल
पर्सनल
प्रोफेशनल
प्रोफेशनल
लाइफ
लाइफ
के लिए बहुत जरूरी है, जो है
है इधर
लीडरशिप इन
लीडरशिप
टफ
इन टफ
टाइम्स।
टाइम्स।
इसमें सर
इसमें
ने
सर ने
बहुत
बहुत
सारे
सारे
टॉपिक्स
टॉपिक्स
कवर
कवर
किए
किए
हैं,
हैं,
मैं तो
मैं तो
इतना नहीं बोल
नहीं बोल
पाऊंगी, क्योंकि
पाऊंगी
ज्यादा
क्योंकि
टाइम
ज्यादा टाइम
नहीं
नहीं
है।
लिया है। लेकिन
लेकिन जो
जो
मैं
मैं
कहना
कहना
चाहती
चाहती
हूँ
हूँ
आज के
आज
इस
के इस
टॉपिक के
टॉपिक के
अंडर
अंडर
में
में
कुछ
कुछ
चीजें
चीजें
हेडलाइन कर
हेडलाइन कर
लूंगी कि
लूंगी कि
जैसे
जैसे
ऑलरेडी
हम
हम
लोग
इस
इस
टाइम
टाइम
बहुत ही
बहुत ही
ज्यादा
ज्यादा
डरे हुए
डरे हुए
हैं
हैं
कोरोना की
कोरोना की
वजह
वजह
से,
से,
और
और
बहुत सारी
बहुत सारी
और भी
और भी
चीजें
चीजें
हैं,
हैं
जैसे
जैसे
आतंकवाद,
आतंकवाद,
क्या नाम है
नाम है
कि
कि
धार्मिक
धार्मिक
कट्टरवाद
कट्टरवाद,
और अंतरराष्ट्रवाद
अंतरराष्ट्रवाद
जैसी
जैसी
प्रेजेंट
प्रेजेंट
सिचुएशन, जिसमें
सिचुएशन
हमें
जिसमें
बहुत
हमें
ही
बहुत
ज्यादा
ही ज्यादा
खतरा है।
खतरा है।
उसके
उसके
बाद
बाद
जो
जो
और भी
और
जो
भी जो
मेन
मेन
चीजें
चीजें
हैं
हैं
वो
वो
है
है ग्लोबलाइजेशन।
ग्लोबलाइजेशन एक
ग्लोबलाइजेशन
ऐसी
एक
चीज
ऐसी चीज
होती
होती
है
है
जिससे हम
जिससे
एक
हम
दूसरे
एक दूसरे
इंटरडिपेंडेंस एक दूसरे
इंटरडिपेंडेंस
से
एक
ग्रो
दूसरे से
करते
ग्रो
हैं,
करते
जैसे
जैसे
इकोनॉमिकली,
इकोनॉमिकली
कल्चरली,
कल्चरली
पॉलिटिकली
पॉलिटिकली
और
और
लिबरलाइजेशन।
लिबरलाइजेशन
इन
इन
दोनों की
दोनों
राह
की
में ये
राह में
बहुत
ये बहुत
ज्यादा
ज्यादा
बड़ा
बड़ा
बहुत बड़ा
बहुत
खतरा
बड़ा
है।
खतरा
इनफैक्ट
इनफैक्ट
इन
इन
इसके
इसके
वजह
वजह
से
से
कई
कई
देशों
देशों
के
के
बीच
बीच
में
में
आपस
आपस
में
में तनाव गहरा हो गया है। इनफैक्ट देश के अंदर भी जो बहुत सारे समुदाय हैं उनके में खतरा उभरता जा रहा है। तो ठीक, तो मैं आप लोग को ये बताना चाहूंगी कि जो इतने बड़े हम लोग के बीच देशों के बीच में जो तनाव है, उनके अंदर जो छोटे छोटे समुदाय हैं उनके बीच में जो तनाव उभर रहा है, उसकी वजह से हमारी जो ट्रेड है, कॉमर्स है, उसको बहुत चोट लग रही है, और हमारी डेमोक्रेटिक वैल्यूज को भी बहुत ज्यादा चोट लग रही है। सर, इन सब छोटी छोटी चीजों को सर बहुत अच्छे से डिटेल में हम लोग को बताएंगे, क्योंकि ऑलरेडी सर इसमें जैनिज्म बारे में, बुद्धिज्म के बारे में बताएंगे, जो बताते हैं कि बहुलवादी संस्कृति को कैसे हम लोग फॉलो करें, मतलब हम लोग किसी को हार्म किए बिना कैसे ग्रो कर सकते हैं हर वे में। तो मैं सर को प्लीज वेलकम करूंगी कि हम लोग को इसके बारे में और अच्छे से बताएं, और रोटेरियन जैन सर को बोलूंगी कि प्लीज उनको वेलकम करें।
थैंक यू वेरी
थैंक यू वेरी
मच,
मच।
थैंक यू वेरी मच रोटेरियन शुभा सिंह जी, आपको एक बहुत अच्छी शुरुआत देने के लिए आज के प्रोग्राम की। डियर रोटेरियंस, गुड इवनिंग। और प्रोफेसर नरेंद्र रस्तगी जी फ्रॉम वॉशिंगटन, गुड मॉर्निंग। फ्रेंड्स, आज हम लोगों के बीच में हार्वर्ड यूनिवर्सिटी के इंटरनेशनल बिजनेस स्कूल के डायरेक्टर नरेंद्र के रस्तगी जी आए हैं। मुझे पर्सनली पता है कि एक लर्नेड पर्सनालिटी हैं और अपने टॉपिक पे इनकी कमांड है, इसके लिए प्लुरलिज्म पे बोलते हैं और बहुत इंटरनेशनली वेरी वेल एक्लेम्ड और नोन फिगर हैं। आज ही हम लोगों का सौभाग्य है कि आज हमारे बीच में आपका आना हुआ है, और इस सब के लिए मैं विशेष रूप से शुक्रिया अदा करना चाहता हूँ आपके जिगरी दोस्त प्रोफेसर जगदीश राय जी का, कि जो कि रोटरी क्लब वाराणसी नॉर्थ के मेंबर हैं। थैंक यू वेरी मच डॉक्टर प्रोफेसर जगदीश राय जी। मैं आज की इस सभा में हमारे डिस्ट्रिक्ट सेक्रेटरी और रोटरी क्लब वाराणसी साउथ के प्रेसिडेंट दीपक अस्थाना जी का स्वागत करता हूं, हमारे क्लब के एजी रोटेरियन संजय गुप्ता जी मीटिंग में हैं। संजय गुप्ता जी, आपका भी मोस्ट वेलकम इन द मीटिंग।
थैंक यू सर,
रोटेरियन
थैंक यू सो मच।
रोटेरियन अनिल जैन जी रोटरी क्लब वाराणसी गंगा के प्रेसिडेंट दिख रहे हैं, मैं आपका भी बहुत बहुत इस मीटिंग में स्वागत करता हूँ। और विभिन्न क्लबों से आए हुए रोटेरियंस और हमारे क्लब के अपने मेंबर्स, आप सभी का बहुत बहुत स्वागत और अभिनंदन है। द स्मॉल इंडस्ट्रीज एसोसिएशन के प्रेसिडेंट, वो भी रोटेरियन ही है, रोटेरियन राजेश भाटिया जी, आपका भी बहुत बहुत स्वागत है आज की इस मीटिंग में। एक नए तरह के टॉपिक पे हम लोगों ने ये मीटिंग अरेंज की है, और आपको मैं बता दूं कि ये कोई भी मीटिंग हम लोग करते हैं, करीब करीब हर संडे को हम लोग मीटिंग करते हैं, इसके पीछे एक दो महीने की कुछ ना कुछ वर्किंग होती है। पिछले 2 महीने से मैं नरेंद्र रस्तगी जी को परेशान कर रहा था, कभी रात में कभी सवेरे व्हाट्सएप पे कॉल करके, अपने छोटे छोटे क्वेश्चन पूछ के कैसे करना है क्या करना है। और बहुत कूल माइंड से प्रोफेसर रस्तगी ने जो हम लोगों को जवाब दिया, हम लोगों के संग जो अटैच किए, मुझे पता है अभी कुछ ही दिन पहले प्रोफेसर रस्तगी किसी सेमिनार को एड्रेस कर रहे थे, 2000 लोगों की गैदरिंग थी, प्रोफेसर डॉक्टर सुब्रमण्यम स्वामी और गोविंदाचार्य जी उस मीटिंग में थे एज ए की नोट स्पीकर। उस मीटिंग को भी आपने एड्रेस किया था। हम लोगों का बहुत छोटा ग्रुप है, 30, 35, 40 लोगों की हमारी गैदरिंग होती है, बट हम लोगों के इनविटेशन को डॉक्टर रस्तगी आपने जो स्वीकार किया है, आई एम रियली वेरी थैंकफुल टू यू फ्रॉम द कोर ऑफ आवर हार्ट। और हम लोगों को लगता है कि आज एक ही नए टाइप का एक्सपीरियंस होगा, एक नए टॉपिक पे सुनने के लिए। सबसे बड़ी बात है, इतने साल से प्रोफेसर रस्तगी यूएस में रह रहे हैं, वहीं से वो अभी एड्रेस भी कर रहे हैं। इन स्पाइट ऑफ दैट उन्होंने मुझे कहा है कि हम लोग पूरा अपना डिलीवरेशन हिंदी में देंगे, सारी चीजें हिंदी में बताएंगे। आई कैन अंडरस्टैंड कि कितनी प्रॉब्लम होती है, लेकिन इवन देन थैंक यू वेरी मच डॉक्टर प्रोफेसर नरेंद्र रस्तोगी जी। इसी के साथ मैं रोटेरियन जगदीश राय जी को आमंत्रित करता हूं कि प्रोफेसर साहब, प्रोफेसर नरेंद्र रस्तगी जी का एक फॉर्मल इंट्रोडक्शन दें, उसके बाद में हम लोग डॉक्टर नरेंद्र रस्तगी जी का डेलिब्रेशन सुन सकें। रोटेरियन जगदीश राय जी।
फ्रेंड्स, मुझे बड़ा अपार हर्ष हो रहा है बहुमुखी प्रतिभा के धनी प्रोफेसर नरेंद्र रुस्तगी का परिचय देते हुए। प्रोफेसर नरेंद्र रुस्तगी, जहाँ तक मुझे ज्ञात है, दिल्ली विश्वविद्यालय से अर्थशास्त्र में मास्टर की उपाधि प्राप्त करने के बाद गए यूएस से। वहाँ से उन्होंने पीएचडी किया और पीएचडी करने के बाद वे हवार्ड यूनिवर्सिटी वाशिंगटन डीसी को ज्वाइन किए। आजकल आप हवार्ड यूनिवर्सिटी वाशिंगटन डीसी के अंतर्राष्ट्रीय व्यापार केंद्र के निदेशक हैं और वहाँ पर प्रोफेसर भी हैं। और ये प्रोफेसर रस्तगी रहा है बहुत सारे विश्वविद्यालयों से और अनेक देशों में, भारत में जहाँ तक मुझे ज्ञात है 2 विश्वविद्यालय हैं, यूनिवर्सिटी यूनिवर्सिटी और आगरा यूनिवर्सिटी। एक तीसरे विश्वविद्यालय के जो उनसे भी बातचीत हुई है, संपर्क हुई है, वो विश्वविद्यालय खोल रहे हैं अभी और वो अपेक्षा करते हैं कि प्रोफेसर रुस्तगी का लेगा। प्रोफेसर रुस्तगी, मैं और प्रोफेसर रुस्तगी हम दोनों ही एक है लिविंग स्टोन कॉलेज नॉर्थ कैरोलिना यूएसए में। हम तीनों मिलकर के कई अंतर्राष्ट्रीय कॉन्फ्रेंस किए हैं बरेली में, जब मैं बरेली में यूनिवर्सिटी विश्वविद्यालय का वाइस चांसलर था। वहाँ पर हम लोगों ने बहुत सारे काम किए, जैसे हमने प्रयास किया एक ऐसे केंद्र की स्थापना जहाँ पर प्राचीन भारतीय विज्ञान प्रौद्योगिकी एवं सभ्यता के विषय में अध्ययन किया जाए। और आपके सहयोग से हमने एक प्रपोजल बनाया, प्रपोजल बना करके मिनिस्ट्री ऑफ ह्यूमन रिसोर्स डेवलपमेंट को हमने भेजा, लेकिन अभी तक वो वहाँ पर पेंडिंग है, क्योंकि मेरे यूनिवर्सिटी विश्वविद्यालय से आने के पश्चात किसी के पास इतना समय नहीं मिला कि जा करके वहाँ पर वो प्रयास कर सके। भारत के अलावा आपका जो सहयोग रहा है ओमान के साथ, नाइजीरिया के साथ, ईरान के साथ, तथा अन्य कई देशों के साथ, और सिर्फ व्यापार ही नहीं, व्यापार प्रबंधन ही नहीं, इनकी बहुत ही रुचि है।
रिकॉर्डिंग कर रहे हैं क्या आप?
जगदीश राय जी म्यूट हो गए हैं, आप आपकी आवाज नहीं आ रही है।
म्यूट हो गए
जी, ठीक है।
हाँ, तो मैं बता रहा था कि व्यापार प्रबंधन के अलावा इनका बहुत बड़ा योगदान है प्राचीन भारतीय संस्कृति, विज्ञान एवं प्रौद्योगिकी का, एवं भारतीय इतिहास में, प्राचीन इतिहास में आपका बहुत बड़ा इंटरेस्ट है, और वहाँ पर उन्होंने बहुत सारा काम किया है। इनका संबंध है कई विश्वविद्यालयों को, उन्होंने हेल्प किया है ओमान में, नाइजीरिया में, ईरान में तथा अन्य देशों में। अभी हाल ही में हम लोगों ने विचार किया, और विचार करने के पश्चात हमने सोचा कि प्राचीन भारतीय विज्ञान प्रौद्योगिकी एवं सभ्यता पर कुछ एक किताब लिखा जाए। वे बहुत कार्य प्रारंभ करेंगे। इनका व्यक्तित्व तो बहुत ही प्रभावशाली है, और आप खुद महसूस करेंगे कि इनके विषय वस्तु का, और इनका सबसे बड़ा विषय वस्तु रहा है सामाजिक बहुलवाद। इन्होंने अध्ययन किया है और पाया है कि मुस्लिम्स के, यानी जो अरब लोगों के आक्रमण से पहले भारत विश्व आर्थिक व्यवस्था का 40% कंट्रोल करता था। जैसे जैसे बहुलवाद खत्म होता गया, वैसे वैसे हमारी आर्थिक स्थिति कमजोर होती गई। जब हमारे यहाँ स्वतंत्रता हुई, बहुलवाद सामने आया, तो हम ग्रो किए। आज हम करीब 15-16% कंट्रोल करते हैं विश्व की इकोनॉमी को, और मुझे पूरा विश्वास है कि प्रोफेसर रुस्तगी का भाषण आप सभी लोगों को बहुत ही पसंद आएगा। तो आप सब लोगों को बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद।
थैंक यू वेरी मच रोटेरियन प्रोफेसर जगदीश राय जी फॉर ए वेरी डिटेल्ड एंड वेरी गुड इंट्रोडक्शन ऑफ प्रोफेसर नरेंद्र के रस्तोगी जी। इसी के साथ मैं अब आमंत्रित करता हूँ प्रोफेसर नरेंद्र रस्तोगी जी को फॉर हिज डेलिब्रेशन। रस्तोगी साहब आप म्यूट हैं। प्रोफेसर रस्तगी साहब आप म्यूट हैं, अनम्यूट करिए। रस्तगी साहब आपकी वॉइस नहीं आ रही है, आप अपने को अनम्यूट करिए। ये जी
आई डिड
करें,
शुरू में हो नहीं रहा था।
करें
आई वुड लाइक टू थैंक शुभा सिंह जी अगेन फॉर इंट्रोड्यूसिंग द टॉपिक, और राय साहब बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद। यू नो राय साहब के साथ कई सालों से हम लोग इस विषय पर बात कर रहे हैं, और जैन साहब, दीपक अस्थाना जी, संजय गुप्ता जी, राजेश भाटिया जी, थैंक्स अ लॉट। एंड एक बार मैं कहना चाहूंगा, जैन साहब आपने कहा मैं हिंदी बोलता हूं पर इतनी अच्छी नहीं बोल पाता कि मैं पूरा लेक्चर अपना हिंदी में दूं, तो बेयर विद मी, जहां हो सकेगा मैं बोलूंगा, बाकी ये इंग्लिश में ही होगा। मुझे अपनी हिंदी दोबारा से ठीक करना है सो दैट आई कैन स्पीक इन इट।
रस्तगी साहब, इंग्लिश लैंग्वेज की हम लोगों को आदत है, इंग्लिश लैंग्वेज की आदत है।
हां, दैट इज वेयर आई वाज कमिंग टू, सो इट वुड बी इन इंग्लिश,
करेक्ट,
और मोर इंग्लिश एंड लिटिल बिट हिंदी,
करेक्ट।
सो होता क्या है कि once you get engrossed in the topic you're talking about by nature now, jaise pehle main hindi mein switch karta tha, ab main english mein switch kar jata hu,
correct, so, we can understand it,
so it would be in english, par jahan par aapko lage to so aap bol dijiyega, to jaise Subhash Singh ji ne kaha ki ये COVID-19 से चीजें काफी बदली, तो किसी भी टॉपिक का कोई संदर्भ होता है, और मेरा इस केस में था कि बचपन में हम लोग सुनते थे कि भारत सोने की चिड़िया थी, तो फिर क्या हुआ, and that is what led me to do more research on the issue and trying to find out ke what went on, and this is what led me to this research, and as Jain Saab said, I had presented a version of this paper at a conference organized by Invertis University that was widely attended. So let me come to the topic and let me share my screen, and in the interest of you being able to see the full screen, let me get out of the view and share my screen. So as I said, we started with the challenge coming because of COVID-19. What it did was it enhanced the problem. The problem already existed, that is the challenges with China, and it had started going with this issue of economic nationalism, started with, you know, migrants moving into European countries, and when Donald Trump was contesting election, he took that issue of China, and that's how this aspect evolved. But what I want to talk about is that this is nothing new. Now, coming back, as Rai Saab said, India was an economic superpower in 1 AD. This is based on data collected by Angus Madison, and India produced roughly 1/3 of the world's GDP. We had focus on ahimsa, and Jainism and Buddhism grew, and you know, anekantvad, I don't need to talk about that, you all know more about it than I do. That was promoted by Jainism. Now, could this have led to the reduction in the development of technology? Because when you look at technology of the time, India had very advanced metallurgical technology, for example. The steel technology was very advanced. For example, if you know the Damascus steel from which the स्टील ब्लेड्स वर मेड, या तलवारें जिससे बनाई गई थी, और वो मेटलर्जिकल टेक्नोलॉजी थी, वो इंडिया से लेके गए थे, साउथ इंडिया में बनता था वो स्टील, और उसको लेके उन्होंने उससे बनाई थी, एंड दैट वाज वन ऑफ द बेस्ट टेक्नोलॉजीज दैट कुड बी यूज्ड तलवार वगैरह बनाने के लिए, एंड वी नो अबाउट द मेटलर्जिकल टेक्नोलॉजी, फॉर एग्जाम्पल वन ऑफ द पिलर्स इज इन न्यू दिल्ली नेक्स्ट टू Qutub Minar, it has still not rusted. So the technology existed, but what happened over time, as we stopped development of our defense technology. Foreign aggressors came, they destroyed our physical assets as well as our knowledge base. For example, India was very advanced in science. Now, what they also did was they tried to change our education system. However, the core belief in pluralism and Ekantavad, that survived. Now, coming further down to more recent time, we have challenges of globalization and economic nationalism. We have superpower struggle, primarily between US and China now. We have domestic challenges in India, for example, mistrust between the Muslims and Hindus, political challenges. So when you look at this, and so I want to take you to the historical context. If you look in our core belief, we essentially believe in Vasudev Kutumbakam. Don't need to expand more on it, but that is who we fundamentally are. And, you know, we have and been tolerating every other one. For example, you probably know, we do not know where the first mosque is because it was destroyed. However, we do know where the second mosque is, and that is in Kerala, India, from the time of Prophet Muhammad. So that acceptance and letting people in, and you can take other examples, say, for example, Parsis came more recently. You had in Gujarat, the Maharaja during British time had let them, the ship come in during World War II, even though Britain had refused entry to the orphans in Britain. So that tolerance had continued. Now, coming back to the GDP numbers to make the point, if you look at this orange line, that is India. So India's percentage of world's GDP was roughly 1/3 in 1 AD, came down to around 4% by 1973. And it has then started to go up. And during this time, when you look at Western Europe, you find it went up from almost nothing. And it's sort of straight transfer from India to Europe. Over time, we know about the destruction of Takshila, Nalanda, and same things happened in other parts of the world. So the technology that existed was destroyed by invaders because they essentially made the point that whatever you have is inferior to what we have. And the way jihad was implemented was destruction of places of worship, be it temples in India, churches in Europe. And along with that, the knowledge base that was destroyed. For example, Aurangzeb changed Akbar's policy and ordered provincial governors to destroy Hindu schools and temples. And that policy continued when the British came. If you take as an example, in 1857, Punjab was almost a literate place. And by the end of the rule of Maharaja Ranjit Singh, you had much less educated persons because you transformed or destroyed the structure. And then English was introduced by force. For example, Lord Macaulay, he said English should be imparted in place of traditional Indian learning. And, systematically destroyed the education system that existed at the time. I mean, this said, you know, produce Indians who were Indian in color and blood, but English in taste. And that is sort of what happened. So, and it's not that it just happened in India, you know, same thing in Romania where communism had spread. So you sort of say, hey, you know, whatever is in our interest is the right thing to do. And you transform education. And I don't need to talk about that. As you know, there is argument now that, you know, the post-colonial colonial government continued similar policy of, you know, divide and rule sort of by playing around with education. Say, for example, the religious education or other education was avoided in India, except for the minorities. So you have India, which was looked to even by Imperial Rome in ancient times, to a status now where our industry that was the best in the world at the time was destroyed during colonial rule, be it the Mughal rule, be it the British rule. So whenever you try to rule another place, one of the things we do is try to convince the community that lost to believe that they are inferior in every regard. And that sort of has continued. Now, how could the decline happen? Anyone's guess? It could be because of the policy of ahimsa we followed, that except for self-defense, you know, as was argued by Jain monks, that you should not fight. Same thing by the Buddhists. That may need more research. But if you come to more recent times, Britain, which was a world power, didn't even have an aircraft carrier by 2017. Now they have two. In 2018, I think they had one more. So US still today has similar concern. It is argued that if war broke out in the China Sea between US and China, US may not win. Now, here is an example of British fleet size and their spent on GDP. They align pretty much. So it has declined significantly over time. So when there was no need, NATO came up, Britain didn't really need as much of power. Similar things happened in France. So when there is no need, in such a short period of time, you see the decline on defense as share of GDP, and similar thing could have happened in India, but that's a guess. Now, let's come back to the value system and the role that incentives play. Pope Urban in 11th century called for crusades. Up until then, in Christianity, killing anyone was not considered, even in war, was not considered right. It was Pope Urban who convinced them that if you do it in the name of Jesus, then it's okay. Fall of Constantinople, 1453, up until then, whenever a place was won over, the soldiers could take whatever movable property they could, and destructions was okay. But when he saw the whole city was being destroyed on the second day, he said, after 2 days, he said, no, not anymore, and stopped. So it is the economic incentive and interest of the ruler that run the show. Emperor Akbar, when there was opposition to him in 1579, he worked with the, I just blanked out on the name of the religious leaders, worked with them to call himself the chief who was above the mullahs, and therefore he could dictate the terms. President Truman in 1945, US knew at that time that Japan was seeking peace, and however, for political reasons, Jimmy Burns advised him that he would be crucified politically, and atom bomb was dropped, and to show the Japanese down. Saudi Arabia, 1950, there was opposition by religious leaders that why should the infidels benefit from the exploration of oil? King Saud said that, hey, you know, because, and he had the religious leaders make a statement that because the oil is being drilled for the benefit of the Muslims, therefore it's okay for the infidels to make money. So it's always economic or the incentive that the ruler has that makes that decision. And, you know, now you must have read about from President Obama about the Congress Party and the Mumbai attack. So don't need to touch on that. Now, economic nationalism. It's essentially looking after the interest of a country or a region. And that's what we all do. And in globalization, it's essentially large scale movement of individuals. And it has occurred in the past. And let's come to the evolution of globalization. The conflict has started with the issue of refugees from various countries, as I started to talk about it. And then with Brexit and President Trump's America First policy to stop exploitation by China. And then obviously COVID-19, magnified the problems. Now, what are our current challenges? Globalization versus free competition, dumping of cheap products to destroy companies for countries, whether it's India or US, stealing of technology, taking control of resources as China is doing now. So why? What's the problem? Ferry said industrial espionage has been going on for centuries. But then China's espionage campaign is on a different scale, as he said. And it becomes an issue if you look at it. The GDP of China as a percentage of US GDP. In short period from 1990 to 2019, it has increased from 5-6% to almost 65%. And if you look at in purchasing power parity terms, China's GDP exceeds that of the US. And it's this issue when it becomes so strong that it becomes really an issue. Not that it has not been going on in the past. US did the same thing. 18th century, US Secretary of Treasury Hamilton, he was even prepared to offer cash rewards for temp and sort of copyright to people who stole technology from other countries. Britain was source of technology at the time. Other European countries sent missions and even facilitated migration of talent from Britain because that was one way of obtaining technology. So nothing new, it has been going on, but just the scale has become a little different in this time, and obviously the information flow. So economic nationalization and globalization, they go hand in hand. When Europe was expanding, democracy was evolving, as I'll show in the next slide. However, the strategy was colonization for rest of the world and democracy at home. So it was the self-interest of European countries, and globalization in description suited, and that was what was promoted. If you look at history of England, you had the tolerance evolving, the democracy evolving over time. Roger II, for example, fought wars using troops that were both Christian and Muslims. And the strategy slowly and gradually evolved. Magna Carta in 1216, you had, you know, country that is England, from absolute monarchy to expansion of parliamentary powers, you know, laws of hearsay so that there was more tolerance, relationship between employer and employee. And as a result, as those laws were being passed, pluralism was sort of expanding. You see a tremendous increase in production. And then that tolerance continued even for immigrants, for example, Dutch engineers, because they had draining technology. They were brought in, same thing from, you know, other parts of the world, that is Netherlands. Cloth industry was expanding because those refugees had the technology. So they were welcomed. Now, should we continue from controlled immigration to uncontrolled, which is the debate today? That's another thing we could, you know, think of. So it was called globalization, but it was in essence using its power to squeeze the maximum that you could, and globalization was a justification. By one estimate, England took roughly the equivalent of 45 trillion by killing Indian cloth industry. As you know, muslin cloth was the best in the world at the time, as compared to the manufactured British cloth. US followed the same strategy. Up until World War II, England, US was on an expansionist strategy. I'll just read through while you can read. But just US believed that God has marked us, the US, as his chosen people, henceforth to lead in the regeneration of the world. And that's where the US expansionist strategy was going on. Come World War II, competition with Russia or USSR, you have Eisenhower Doctrine. He singled out the threat from Soviet Union. Under this doctrine, US was willing to use our armed forces to defend countries against armed aggression. So it is the need of the time which transformed from pure aggressors to more tolerant in a more competitive environment. Now, what's happening in case of China? We know the Belt and Road Initiative, the economic espionage by the Chinese, especially from the US. They are expanding their power around the world using loans. And, you know, sometimes they are loans, but mostly they are trying to gain control. They are spending huge amounts of money to do that. Of course, the estimates vary, but it could be anywhere from 1.2 to 1.3 trillion. They give loans, and in the process, it seems that the objective is to take control when the country is not able to pay the loans back. For example, in Ceylon, they Sri Lanka, they did that. Kazakhstan had similar challenges. So is it what the Europe did by colonizing other parts of the world? Is this what China is trying to do? it is anybody's guess, but that is what may be happening. And that, as I showed in the slide before, when a country grows so fast compared to in relation to United States, for example, as part of our GDP, the country has to take notice. And that is where the economic nationalism comes in. Now, let's look at pluralism and how that has helped India in the past, and can we use that strategy? If you look at the growth during the Mughal periods, the caliphs, they were sending delegates of scholars all over the world to obtain knowledge base. During 7th and 8th centuries, both Muslims and non-Muslims were encouraged. The books were obtained, for example, from India, translated into Arabic to transfer knowledge. And because it went from Arabian countries to Europe, it was called, for example, the Arabic numeral system. Now, if you look at, to put it in context, the reason I am taking Pakistan as an example is because India and Pakistan evolved from the same country, India, before 1947. In India, the pluralistic strategy evolved or has stayed. It's in our blood, or whichever way you want to put it. Pakistan did not follow that strategy. And when you look at the casualties in Pakistan and the loss because of terrorism, even though it's a Muslim country, the Shia-Sunni challenges haven't gone away. Pakistan didn't even want to retain the only Nobel Prize winner, and he left the country because the parliament passed regulation that they were non-Muslims. And that issue continues. Another way of looking at it is from the angle of patents. If you look at number of patents in India, you see a straight line trajectory going up, and not so for Pakistan or Bangladesh. I've used different scale, because if you used one scale, they would just flat out. So India, for example, is 6,000 or so, and Pakistan is much less. So the point being that you have an improvement in the technology skills. Another way of looking at it is to look at the globalization of competition. For example, UNESCO Airbus competition, where any group can apply, participate in that competition. And if you look at grand prize winners, Indian team was the grand prize winner in 2015. Another way of looking at it is NASA's Space Settlement Contest. This is for high school students by various grade levels. And if you look at country of origin, initially we didn't have any grand prize winner, but as the education system evolved and the underlying system of pluralism, I believe, helps in terms of free thinking, that you have a larger number. And this point is made even clearer if you look at all first place, second place, third place winners at all grade levels. and you find that the trend for India is in, you know, a significant positive direction. So, in summary, countries do what is in their best interest, and within that, individual leaders do what is in their best interest. Education and its transformation has a role. This role was played wherever session took place, and we always convinced the group that lost that they are inferior. If you watch the television series Crown about the British monarchy, you see how Africans were talked about as being not educated and brought into the modern stream by colonization. While if you look at Africa, you have structures, for example, steles in Ethiopia, that couldn't have been built without some advanced technology at the time. Pluralism, the point I make is it creates an environment for growth of new knowledge. However, we as a country, or any country for that matter, has to work towards protecting its physical assets as well as intellectual property. Of course, we need to promote competitiveness of businesses because monopolies create other types of problems. Now, if we continue on those strategies, I believe that we need to talk about pluralism in ancient India and now, and how the destruction could have taken place. We need to think about who we were and what led to our decline so that we control that aspect of it. We obviously need to be teaching history from Indian perspective and not invaders' perspective. Now, be honest about history, as enough evidence is coming forward that Ramayana and Mahabharata were not just epics, they are part of our history. We need to see the strength in our ancient systems, for example, Ayurveda and Yoga. And that's another topic we can talk about. And we need to talk about promotion of pluralistic principles, not just in India, but around the world. If we do not stand up for that challenge and other parts of the world, the promotion in India alone won't really help as much. Now, do they help in our businesses? As we know, if we incorporate tolerance in our businesses, the growth that would come by inclusion of everyone helps. Could that be the reason, for example, of people of Indian origin, or when you look at number of CEOs of Indian origin, which has been increasing, that we come from a place where we work within differences and that aspect continues? Would we need to incorporate in our lives? We always do when situation dictates it. An example always stays with me. we had a family friend, that is my uncle's family friend. And they were the first ones we went to when we moved to Washington, D.C. And Sharma auntie was so strict vegetarian that when they purchased a house, they replaced all kitchen things, for example, dishwasher, electric range, and the whole bit, because the previous owner was probably cooking meat in the kitchen. However, when their children started eating meat, auntie would prepare masalas for them to put it on chicken. They had their oven and the whole kitchen set up in the basement where children would cook, and the plates that they would take down from the kitchen upstairs wouldn't go back. But the adjustment was made because without it, they would lose out on children. Could we not do the same thing in our relationships? Like the problems we had where we as Hindus wouldn't want to drink water in houses of Christians and Muslims. When you're in majority, you sort of do that and not forced to take, but should we not look at those issues? For example, talking about buildings in Mumbai where they are working on not letting meat eaters purchase flats. So when you are a dominant part, you can force it, but you don't look at it from the perspective of the one who is being impacted. And once you start to look at it from that perspective, you are able to make appropriate changes that would facilitate coexistence and growth in the process. So that is what I have. If you have some questions, I would be glad to answer. I hope I completed within the time frame you had provided me. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor Rastagi. You have compiled the whole thing, such a big aspect, such a big data, in such a nice manner. What are the countries, how they have developed, what were their strategies, and how the things are going on. It's such a nice compilation you have explained in a very lucid manner. Thank you very much for all your efforts. I know it's very early morning in the US, and you have all taken all the pains of doing all these things. Definitely members are enriched with your deliberation. May I request any member, if anyone has having any question on these topics or related topics. I have only one question. Before that, I ask our members to please unmute themselves and raise the query if you have.
I have a comment and I will give later.
Permit, I have one question.
Pradeep Jalanji, please ask the question.
हाँ, हमें ये प्रॉब्लम लग रही है कि प्लुरलिज्म ही डेवलपमेंट का एक कारण है, ऐसा नहीं लगता हमें. हमारे ख्याल से जहाँ डिक्टेटरशिप होती है, जैसे रशिया में था, ब्रेजनेव एरा में डिक्टेटरशिप ऑफ द प्रोलिटेरियट था, वहाँ बहुत तेजी से 20-30 साल तक डेवलपमेंट हुआ. फिर पेरेस्ट्रोका आते ही सब डिस्ट्रॉय हो गया, डिसइंटीग्रेशन हो गया. वैसे ही चाइना में अभी शी जिनपिंग का पीरियड है, शी जिनपिंग के पीरियड में भी बहुत तेजी से वो हावी हो रहे हैं, लेकिन खत्म होती है वहाँ डाउनफॉल चालू हो जाता है. वैसे यूएसए में कंटिन्यूअस डेमोक्रेसी है, तो उनका कंटिन्यूअस डेवलपमेंट एंड ग्रोथ हो रहा है. तो प्लूरलिज्म इज नॉट द ओनली थिंग which encourages growth. I think you can guide me.
Jahan sahab, you are right. Pluralism is not the only thing. It, as I said, it creates an environment for growth of new knowledge during peaceful periods. The periods you talked about, whether it's Russia or China, it's easier to catch up because you know where you are headed. And by dedicating your resources as China did, right? They were able to catch up. But would the new knowledge generation, as I showed in case of school kids competing and all that, it's the new knowledge creation is what I believe comes faster during where environment on pluralism plays. You can see the industrialization that occurred in Europe. It occurred as the tolerance grew. I can go back to the slide on Europe, you would find that, let me go further up. So if you look at that, you find that the tolerance was improving. I didn't have too many slides on this because that wasn't the focus, but you would find that during this period, you had tolerance increasing from an absolute monarchy, priests being very powerful, to protests by Martin Luther, parliament becoming more powerful, tolerance increasing, with a relationship between employer and employee. So that is what I was talking about. Now, you can always dedicate your resources for a particular cause. And you can also see, for example, during period of Mao, a large number of Chinese were killed because they were showing that because of Mao's revolution, agriculture production was going up while it was not. And the decision was based on the fact, the data that production was going up while people were dying in the villages. So fast forward, Xi Jinping, yes, as you have absolute control, you transfer resources to the universities. Chinese universities now have much more resources than even US universities do. And you see China trying to take control through giving grants to US universities. Harvard University is the largest one that is receiving, close to $100 million through Chinese funds. Then the number of Chinese students they send, that gives revenue to US universities, Australian universities. So you are right. It is not the pluralism versus totalitarianism. You take control. Russia advanced during totalitarianism, but economically it was a bankrupt economy. Now, whether perestroika should have taken place or not, you know, you abruptly killed an economy from where it was as compared to China, which gradually moved from a totalitarian economy to a more market-based economy. Do you see the point?
Yeah, you are right.
So, I mean, you are right that on the surface, it seems as you go from totalitarianism to less control, the economy improves, yes. But it's not because of totalitarianism, it's because of the opening up of the economy. Now, during this period, China also was involved in huge theft of intellectual property which US was looking the other way until we reached at a point where your own economic existence is at stake. And that's what led to economic nationalism and Trump, winning the election in 2016.
Yes, you are right.
That's my view.
Yeah, you are right. Thank you.
Thank you,
Pradeep Jalanji. May I ask Mr. Anil Kinjavadekar ji to raise the question? Anil Kinjavadekar. Please unmute kariye. Anil Kinjavadekar ji ke baad mein koi someone marked as Galaxy M20.
AK Ghosh.
Haan, AK Ghosh ji. Yes, sir. Please raise your question. Thank
you. No. Afterwards or now?
Immediately, please.
It was a wonderful deliberation on various aspects. It started with, naturally, I'm a metallurgist, frankly, and it started with Mr. Sagi with a metallurgical example of a Damascus soda and the iron pillar. Well, I'm happy about that. Thank you. You had been talking about the new researches that you have carried out and a logical approach on the historical background of the economic development at international level vis-a-vis India. What I was now thinking is, internationally, we are quite aware about the economic espionage and IP theft and doling out enormous amount of money at lower interest rates to countries, etc. What Chinese are doing is taking them up. But instead of talking about international all the way, I was thinking about what exactly can be done by our leaders nationally. Because what we are now seeing is the production is getting enormously hampered due to huge migration of the workforce in the COVID time. Industries are still having a huge pressure and reeling under it. Economy is not opening up at all. I mean, we might be claiming anything. What can be done for that? I think your expert view might be useful for us.
About that, you probably know more than I do. in my opinion, we obviously have to increase competitiveness and facilitate flow of technology. For example, I don't have the slide on in this presentation. Ministry of Information and Technology in Japan, MITI, they had facilitated flow of technology at a reasonable cost, from US companies. They enhanced competition while controlling the coming in of companies. For example, when beer companies wanted to Coke, I don't remember it was Coke or Pepsi, they wanted to go to Japan. They restricted their entry until they facilitated Kirin beer in their production. And similar strategies were followed by US, for example, as I showed in a slide. They supported even stealing of technology from other countries, but promoted competition at home. And that is what we didn't do in India to promote more competitiveness in the economy while controlling flow of technology. So that is what I think would have to happen more of, that we support the flow of technology and at the same time make sure we enhance competitiveness of our industries. And I believe that is what we would be pushing more for, based on what I have read about the strategies followed in other countries.
We followed in India.
Thank you.
Right.
Thank you, Professor A.K. Ghoshji. Thank you for your question.
Thank you, sir.
I have a comment.
Yes, Jagdish Rayaji, please.
जहां तक लीडरशिप का सवाल है टफ टाइम में यूनाइटेड स्टेट्स ऑफ अमेरिका में 1930s में टफ टाइम था, बहुत बड़ा इकोनॉमिक रिसेशन था, लोगों को नौकरी नहीं मिल रही थी, हाईली एजुकेटेड लोग थे, लेकिन उस समय कुछ लोग आए हार्वर्ड, उन्होंने अपना इंडस्ट्री बिजनेस शुरू किया, बहुत चीप लेबर मिला, हाईली क्वालिफाइड लेबर, बहुत ही चीप, परिणाम ये हुआ कि बहुत सारी कंपनीज जैसे हेवलेट एंड पैकर्ड, एचपी, आईबीएम, फोर्ड एंड अदर्स को आए उभर करके सामने और ग्लोबल लीडर बने। इस कोरोना के टाइम में भारत में भी दवाओं की मैन्युफैक्चरिंग, मेडिकल इक्विपमेंट की मैन्युफैक्चरिंग स्टार्ट हो गई है और मेरा विश्वास है कि जब भी टफ टाइम आता है तो वो अपॉर्चुनिटी लेकर के आता है और इस गैदरिंग में बहुत अधिकतर बिजनेसमैन हैं। अब मैं उनको आह्वान करता हूं कि आप आइए, आकर के कोई बिजनेस शुरू कीजिए और डिफरेंट थिंग, मैन्युफैक्चरिंग एंड अदर थिंग्स। खुद मेरे पास बहुत सारे इंजीनियर्स और साइंटिस्ट अप्रोच करते हैं नौकरी के लिए, मेरे पास कोई नौकरी नहीं है, आप उनको हायर कीजिए, आगे बढ़िए। दूसरी चीज मैं ये कहना चाहता हूँ कि प्रोफेसर रुस्तगी के लेक्चर में उन्होंने कहा था अहिंसा के विषय में, और हम यदि अति सिद्धांतवादी हैं तो हम समाज का नुकसान करते हैं। उदाहरण जब अति सिद्धांतवाद आया है, उदाहरण स्वरूप जवाहरलाल नेहरू ने तिब्बत एकार्ड साइन किया चाइना के साथ, पाकिस्तान के साथ को फेस को ले गए यूनियन में और पंचशील साइन किया चाइना के साथ, उन्होंने मान लिया कि अब हम एकदम पीसफुल हो गए, हमें जरूरत नहीं है किसी हथियार की, किसी चीज की। मुझे अच्छी तरह याद है कि कानपुर में एक गन फैक्ट्री थी जिसको उन्होंने बंद करा दिया और कहा कि हमें जूतों की जरूरत है न कि गन की। परिणाम क्या हुआ, चाइना ने 1962 में धोखा दिया, अटैक किया, तब जाके चेतना आई भारत में और फिर जाकर के उस चेतना का परिणाम था 1971 का वार। तो जब जब हम अति सिद्धांतवादी रहे, जब मुस्लिम अटैक करते थे तो हिंदू कहते कि कहीं हम रात में अटैक नहीं करेंगे, ये सिद्धांत के खिलाफ है, जो बिना हथियार का है उस पर हम वार नहीं करेंगे, ये सिद्धांत का खिलाफ है, लेकिन वो लोग रात में ही वार करते थे, अटैक करते थे, आज जिनके हाथ में हथियार नहीं है उन पर अटैक करते थे, उनको मारते थे। सिद्धांतवाद बहुत अच्छा है, जरूरी है, लेकिन अति सिद्धांतवाद बहुत ही बुरा होता है समाज के लिए। ये मेरा एक कमेंट था, थैंक यू।
थैंक यू प्रोफेसर जगदीश राय जी। एनी अदर क्वेश्चन प्लीज। रस्तगी साहब, मैं जस्ट आई वांटेड टू नो वन थिंग with the historical compilation data and your experience, what do you see, which country will lead the world in future?
Who knows? I wish I knew, I would be buying stocks there. I mean, but honestly, I do believe that India would be a major player, honestly.
Yeah, I do think so. Yeah. That India will be a major player in the future.
Why so? Why not China?
Because at some point, you see, the thing is, this became clear, for example, in the COVID crisis. right? It would depend on what kind of relationships we are able to build. If US and India continue to grow on that path, you see, China is, I believe, following that strategy of colonization.
Correct.
And that is, you know, having an impact on their relationships, I believe. Like African countries, for example, are not very trusting. You know, India has been improving our relationships with African countries and other parts of the world. And so if this relationship keeps improving, and I believe that is in the interest of both India and United States to build on that. And with that, and our basic thinking of openness leads to improved relationships. And I hope that path would continue. And with that, I believe, you know, India would be a major player regardless. Now, things like some of the common problems, for example, both India and US are facing, and that's because of, you know, our democracy that we play to the vote bank. But that's the nature of the beast. Otherwise, be it India or be it United States, we shouldn't be supporting illegal immigration. But there is support for that in India. There is support for that in the United States. So as I observed in my studies, where the migration was for the talent pool, the country advances. And wherever there is intolerance, for example, Germany was intolerant. Therefore, all the scientists from Germany came to the United States, a large number of them, the Jewish scientists, and contributed to the scientific developments, including atomic technology in the US. But if we continue this path of uncontrolled immigration, would that strain our social security system? I believe so, but time will tell. So, and I also wanted to thank you, Jayan Saab, for accommodating and moving the time from 6 a.m. to 8 a.m.
Okay. Thank you very much for your nice deliberation. अब स्लोगन चेंज होने वाला, हिंदी चीनी भाई भाई की जगह भारत अमेरिका भाई भाई होने वाला है आपके साथ. थैंक यू. मे आई नाउ रिक्वेस्ट आवर डिस्ट्रिक्ट सेक्रेटरी एंड प्रेसिडेंट ऑफ रोटरी क्लब वाराणसी साउथ फॉर ए फॉर्मल वोट ऑफ थैंक्स टू प्रोफेसर नरेंद्र रस्तगी जी एंड द एंटायर टीम बिहाइंड दिस शो. Rotarian Deepak Asthana ji, please.
आवाज आ रही है?
हाँ, आ रही है, बिल्कुल आ रही है.
धन्यवाद. बाबा विश्वनाथ की नगरी से सर्वप्रथम वाशिंगटन में बैठे हमारे प्रोफेसर नरेंद्र जी को सादर नमन. और हमारे बीच बीडी गुजराती भाई भी उपस्थित हैं बेंगलोर से. हम आपका भी स्वागत करते हैं और साथ ही साथ अभिनंदन भी करते हैं. आज नरेंद्र जी ने इतनी सारी बातें आपने हम लोगों को बताई जो कि बहुत सी जानकारियां हम लोगों को नहीं थी, और बहुत ही अच्छा लगा कई नई चीजों को जानकर. इसके लिए हम पूरी टीम के तरफ से आपके सहे दिल से धन्यवाद देते हैं और अपने आभार प्रकट करते हैं कि आपने अपने बहुमूल्य समय निकाल कर हम सभी लोगों को इतनी महत्वपूर्ण जानकारी उपलब्ध कराएं. साथ ही साथ हम अपने डायनेमिक प्रेसिडेंट रोटरी क्लब नॉर्थ सतीश जैन जी एवं सचिव सुरेश खंडेलवाल भाई साहब का तहे दिल से धन्यवाद प्रकट करते हैं कि आप लोग लगातार ऐसी मीटिंग का आयोजन करते रहे, हर हफ्ते संडे को लोगों को इंतजार रहता है। बहुत ही अच्छी मीटिंग का आयोजन हो रहा है, आपको बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद। हम बनारस के 10 क्लबों के साथ ये मीटिंग कर रहे हैं, साथ ही साथ स्मॉल इंडस्ट्रीज के अध्यक्ष राजेश भाटिया जी को भी बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद। आप भी रोटरी सनराइज के मेंबर हैं और साथ ही साथ अध्यक्ष भी हैं स्मॉल एसोसिएशन ऑफ इंडस्ट्रीज के, आपका आभार। हमारे बीच जगदीश राय जी एक्स वाइस चांसलर बैठे हैं, आपको भी आभार सर, और आपकी वजह से ही आज हम लोग इतनी मीटिंग का आनंद उठा पाए। एक बार फिर से आप सभी को हमारी तरफ से सादर नमन और बहुत बहुत आभार, धन्यवाद।
अस्ताना जी थैंक्स,
थैंक यू वेरी मच। और लास्ट में मैं धन्यवाद देना चाहता हूँ आज के हमारी प्रोग्राम कन्वीनर रोटेरियन सुभाष सिंह जी को फॉर हिज ऑल द पेन्स ही हैज टेकन फॉर ऑर्गेनाइजिंग ऑल दिस प्रोग्राम, एंड बिग थैंक्स, थैंक यू वेरी मच। नमन है नरेंद्र रस्तोगी जी आपको, आपने इतना टाइम निकाला हम लोगों के लिए अपने व्यस्त समय से हॉट टाइम में, थैंक यू वेरी मच। हम लोग फिर आपसे जरूर कनेक्ट होंगे एंड योर पर्सनैलिटी इज रियली प्लेजेंट, कई मौका मिला तो फिजिकली भी आपसे जरूर मिलेंगे आइदर यूएस और इन इंडिया। थैंक यू वेरी मच, थैंक यू एवरीवन,
थैंक यू,
थैंक यू।